Show right here on 9:10 a.m. Superstation Future Radio. Right before the break, we were talking about should African Americans celebrate St. Patrick's Day. Do you know what you're celebrating? We're dealing with the history of St. Patrick's Day. Now, for some reason, my live broadcast on Facebook and YouTube just all of a sudden ended. Okay, so this is part two. All right, so when I go back and edit it, I have to put these two together. I don't know what happened, but anyway. So we were looking at this article from history.com, the official website of the History Channel. Who is St. Patrick? And there's a section here that talks about St. Patrick incorporated Irish culture into Christian lessons. St. Patrick incorporated Irish culture into Christian lessons. Now, familiar with the Irish language, and he spoke Irish, and culture, Patrick chose to incorporate traditional ritual into his lessons of Christianity instead of attempting to eradicate native beliefs. And you're going to see this take place. You're going to see this happen. If we look at and also if you read Christianity Before Christ by Dr. John G. Jackson, Dr. John G. Jackson deals with this, with some of the history and some of the different holidays. But if we look at why Christmas is celebrated on December 25th, and if you've seen some of my presentations before or taken any of my online classes, you know, I talk about the book, The Life of Christ. And this was put out by the American Bible Society. Okay. And this edition came out in 2011, The Life of Christ. And I saw it. I was at a CVS pharmacy in Detroit on Jefferson. And I bought it because of what it talks about on page 55. All right. Now, this may go outside the circumference of some people's awareness, but it talks about why Christmas is celebrated on December 25th. And it says in Christianity's early years, people debated when Jesus' birthday should be celebrated. Now, keep in mind, the letter J didn't even exist at this point in time. His name was Yeshua. Some Christians were against observing Yeshua's birthday at all, as they did not want Jesus or Yeshua compared to Pharaoh and Herod. Now, Pharaoh is a title. That's not even a name. Pharaoh or Nesubiti, that's not even a name. That's a title. And because the Pharaoh's or Herod's birthdays were commemorated. But in the 4th century AD, Pope Julius I made it official. Christ's birth would be celebrated on December 25th. Now, there was no evidence for this. Nowhere in the biblical text or the Helios Biblos, the Sun book, does it state that Jesus the Christ is born on December 25th. But this coincided with when many of the other sun deities, when their celebrations were, or their birthdays, coming from various cultures. And if you read Christianity Before Christ by Dr. John G. Jackson, he deals with this in the book, Christianity Before Christ by Dr. John G. Jackson. So, we continue here. December 25th was already commemorated as the birthday of the sun, the S-U-N, not the S-O-N. Using the technology available at the time, ancient astronomers observed that on December 25th, the day started getting longer again. Because on December 20th or December 21st, the sun moves into its lowest position in this annual travel throughout the constellations. And on December 22nd, 23rd, 24th, it appears the sun does not move. So it said the sun, the S-U-N, was dead or still for 3 days. Then on December 25th, the sun moves 1 degree northward. And starting on December 25th, there's an increase in the amount of sunlight in each subsequent day after December 25th, there's more and more sunlight. So in ancient times, December 25th, regardless of what calendar they were using, that day marked the rebirth of the sun, or the birth of the Son of God, not the S-O-N, but the S-U-N. So December 25th was already considered the birthday of the sun. Using the technology available at the time, astronomers observed that on December 25th, the days started getting longer again. They recognized the date as the winter solstice, when the sun is born again each year. Okay. And this deals with astronomy. The Romans celebrated the birthday of the god Sol Invictus, S-O-L. That prefix Sol means sun, S-U-N. The god Sol Invictus, which means unconquered sun, they celebrated the birthday of the deity Sol Invictus on December 25th. The day was also recognized as the birthday of Mithra, the sun deity of the ancient Persians, and as the birthday of Attis, an agricultural deity worshipped in Asia Minor. By choosing December 25th, the church avoided upsetting the masses. No one wanted their festivals canceled, so the Christian church simply combined this new Christian holiday with quote-unquote pagan traditions. Because the Roman Empire is expanding and conquering other people, so what you do is you incorporate into what you celebrate already what they're celebrating, and this is a way that this makes it easier to conquer people, because you're not just forcing something in totally new into people. They can see elements of what they celebrate and what they practice and what is being forced upon them. We'll continue this on the other side of the break. You listen to the African History Network show right here on 910 AM Superstation, the Future Radio. I'm your host, Brother Michael Imhotep. We'll be back in a few minutes. Stand by. Back from break in 4 minutes. Back from break in 4 minutes. How's everybody doing? All right, back from break in 4 minutes. This is part two because our broadcast was cut off on Facebook and YouTube. Stand by. Okay, back from break in 3 minutes. Okay, if you like this type of information, you can support the African History Network, $ the AHN show through Cash App. $ the AHN show through Cash App. Also through PayPal, paypal.me/theAHNShow. All right, how you doing, Eric? Be sure to register for the online classes I teach on Saturdays and Sundays, Ancient Kemet, the Moors, and the Maafa. Understanding the transatlantic slave trade, what they didn't teach you in school. Back from break in 1 minute. Welcome back to the African History Network show right here on 910 AM Superstation, the Future Radio. All right, let's go back to dealing with some of the history of St. Patrick's Day. And should African Americans celebrate St. Patrick's Day? So we talked about some of the history of Christmas, why Christmas is celebrated on December 25th. I've done a 3-hour presentation dealing with that ancient Kemet, the winter solstice, and the history of Christmas. I also deal with some of the history of Christmas, some in the online class I teach, Ancient Kemet, the Moors, and the Maafa, Understanding the Transatlantic Slave Trade, what they didn't teach you in school. And when we look at solstice, okay, the winter solstice, the word solstice comes from solstere. Let me pull this up. Hold on. What is this doing here? Okay. When we break down the word solstice, the prefix sol means sun, and suffix sestere comes from solstitum, which means stand still. Okay, so the word solstice literally means sun stand still. And we know on December 22nd, 23rd, 24th, the sun appears that it does not move. On December 25th, the sun moves 1 degree northward. Okay, you can check out McGraw-Hill Dictionary of Aviation or Merriam-Webster or Encyclopedia Britannica on what the winter solstice is. Okay, let's continue. So St. Patrick incorporated Irish culture into Christian lessons. Okay. For instance, he used bonfires to celebrate Easter, since the Irish were used to honoring their deities or gods with fire. Easter, Istra, Oistra, Ishtar. Easter, Istra, Oistra, Ishtar. All those names are connected. He also superimposed a sun, S-U-N, a powerful Irish symbol, onto the Christian cross to create what is now called a Celtic cross, so that veneration of the symbol would seem more natural to the Irish. So he understands Irish culture, and he's incorporating elements into Irish culture, into what there was being forced upon them, because Patrick killed thousands of Druids. He killed thousands of the Irish to force Christianity on them. Okay, we're going to come to that in just a second. Patrick was a mass murderer. This may go outside this encompass of some people's awareness. Patrick was a mass murderer. You can also call a colonizer, because the Roman Empire sends him into Ireland to convert the Irish to Christianity. So he was a mass murderer, and you can call him a colonizer as well. So if you celebrate St. Patrick's Day, I think it's important for you to know at least the history of what you're participating in. Now, if you want to celebrate a mass murderer, okay, well, I mean, that's on you, you know. Although there were a small number of Christians on the island when Patrick arrived, most Irish practiced a nature-based, what Europeans call a pagan religion, a nature-based pagan religion. But let's look at that term pagan, though. What does that term pagan mean? Because pagan does not necessarily mean something negative. It has been given a negative connotation. Okay, if we look at the point, and I think I have it here in the presentation, dealing with pagan. These are actual slides from the class. Hold on, let me find this here. So pagan comes from paganus. Pagan just means something that's indigenous to a group of people. Pagan doesn't necessarily mean something negative. Okay, it had, because of European anthropology, okay, pagan has been given a negative connotation. And actually, it is in Okay, we have it in the one, my presentation on Christmas. So what we're going to do, we're going to pull up that presentation right quick here. Because I want to show you this here. This one right here. Okay, Ancient Kemet, the Winter Solstice, and the History of Christmas. And I have a slide on what is pagan. Okay, so let's go to this. This is slide 22 in this other presentation. So let's look at this, because it's important to understand words, the meaning of words, the etymology of words, because, you know, the English language plays some tricky games with words. All right. So what is pagan? All right. Pagan is a word that is misused to speak negatively about a group of people. If we look at the American Heritage Dictionary, but you can look at Merriam-Webster, you can look at any dictionary you want to. Don't look at Webster. look at Merriam-Webster. Don't look at Emmanuel Lewis. He just had a birthday. All right. But anyway, an adherent of a polytheistic religion in antiquity, especially when viewed in contrast to an adherent of a monotheistic religion. But even when you talk about monotheism and polytheism, but when you study like the spiritual systems in ancient Kemet and traditional African spiritual systems, they believed in one supreme being. They just had different helpers, emissaries, different manifestations of that one supreme being. You have, but in Christianity, so just like when you deal with ancient Kemet, you deal with the Netaru, Osar, Oset, Heru, you do Ma'at, different things like this, the different manifestations of the one supreme being, Dahuti, etc. Right? Well, they're replaced in Christianity by the saints. Because in Christianity, you have what are called patron saints, and the patron saints watch over different groups of people, just like the Netaru was said to watch over different groups of people. So Patrick is the patron saint of Ireland. Saint Maurice, the African Moor, Saint Maurice was the patron saint of Germany. Well, Saint Nicholas is the patron saint of prostitutes, pawnbrokers, moneylenders, children, and Saint Nicholas, the real Bishop Nicholas, who becomes canonized as a saint, is the real person that the mythological character, the secular figure of Santa Claus, is based upon, with the influence coming from center class, which is Dutch. Center class in Dutch means Saint Nicholas, who was a religious figure. And center class also had a sidekick named Joite Piet, Black Pete. Okay, we deal with Joite Piet right here. It's right here. Joite Piet, Black Pete. So in November through December 5th or so in the Netherlands, they have the celebration, the parade honoring Joite Piet and Black Pete. And these Europeans put on blackface, Afro wigs, red lipstick, and these outfits and imitate the Moors. Because Joite Piet, Black Pete, he was a Moor. Okay, those watching on Facebook and YouTube, keep watching for a few more minutes. We're going to keep broadcasting and wrap this up. We'll be back. I'll be on Roland Martin Unfiltered on Friday. So check me out there as well. Right now, it's correct. Wrong behavior. It's not over till we win. Wakanda forever. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Peace. All right. Stand by. Let me disconnect this call with the radio station. Okay. So we have this. See, all this history is connected. This history is connected. Connects you to history, culture, language, religion, spiritual systems, all that. This is all connected. All right. Now, make a long story short. Let's go back to pagan. What is pagan? All right. So an adherent of a polytheistic religion in antiquity, especially when viewed in contrast to an adherent of a monotheistic religion. And then they'll say Akhenaten created monotheism and all this. African people always believed in one supreme being. They believed in different emissaries, different manifestations of that one supreme being. Okay. But even in Christianity, right? Wasn't it Gabriel who was the messenger angel that delivered the Annunciation to the Virgin Mary. Okay. Well, when you study the stories of the Annunciation and the Virgin Birth and the Immaculate Conception, those are ancient stories. Those stories date back to about 3300 BC in ancient Kemet. Let me see. I'll show you another slide that deals with that, because I'm going between two different presentations here. Well, if we look at pagan, you look at the etymology of the word pagan, comes from the late Latin, Middle English, from late Latin, paganus, from Latin. It means country dweller, civilian, from pagus, country or rural district. And pagan just meant basically, just like we talk about, we may joke and talk about people down in the country, they're in Alabama, Mississippi, they're real country, they were backwards, something like that, right? But it's the same thing here. And it was just something, pagan was just referred to as something that was practiced or indigenous to people in a rural district in the country or something like that. Pagan was not necessarily something negative. The word pagan has been given a negative connotation, but it's not negative in its essence. Okay. If we look at just so we have something to compare this with, right? If we look at, let's close that one out. I want to go back to this one here, ancient Kemet, the Moors and the Maafa, understanding the transatlantic slave trade, what they didn't teach you in school. I want to go back to this PowerPoint presentation, because when we look at the virgin birth, the Immaculate Conception, things like this, right? That is a retelling of a very ancient story. And I want to go to, page 95. So this is slide 98. All right. Let's pick it up here, slide 98. Make a long story short. Okay, so this is from page 95 of Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization by Tony Browder. And Browder is a friend of mine. I've interviewed him a number of times. Brilliant historian and archaeologist. Okay, so it talks about how at the bottom of this page, the story of Osar, Aset, and Heru, who the Greeks called Osiris, Isis, and Horus, is the first story in the recorded history of a holy royal family, the Trinity. Of a holy royal family. The Immaculate Conception, the Virgin Birth, and the Resurrection. Okay? Evidence of this Trinity is known to have existed in ancient Nubia or Ta-Nehisi as late as 3300 BCE, before the Common Era, 3300 BCE or BC, carved onto the walls of the Temple of Luxor. Around 1380 BCE, before the Common Era or BC, are scenes that depict the following. So you have four scenes here. At the bottom left, you have what's known as the Annunciation. The Neter Dehuti is shown announcing to the Virgin Aset the coming birth of their son Heru. The Greeks called Aset Isis. Okay, and when you look at the Notre Dame Cathedral and you research the Notre Dame Cathedral, it's built on the remains of two temples. One of them was a temple dedicated to Isis. The words Notre Dame means Our Lady. So you have Dehuti, who's the Neter of divine articulation of speech and math and science and things like this. Dehuti delivering to Aset the Annunciation. Well, in the story of the Virgin Mary, it was Gabriel, the messenger angel, who delivered the Annunciation. The angels are helpers, emissaries of the deity, of God. All right. Then you have in panel two, you have the Immaculate Conception. The Neter Neph, K-N-E-P-H, who represents the Holy Ghost, and the Neter Het Heru, Hetheru, or Hathor, who the Greeks called Hathor, are shown symbolically impregnating Osset by holding the Ankh, which is the eternal symbol of life, or the African symbol of life, the Ankh, to the nostrils of the virgin mother to be. Then in panel three, you have the virgin birth. Osset is shown sitting on the birthing stool, and the newborn child is attended by midwives. And then in panel four, you have the adoration. The newborn Heru is portrayed receiving gifts from the three kings or magi while being adored by a host of gods and men. Now, in the Helios Biblos in the Bible, when they talk about the three wise men or the kings, they don't say how many, but three is associated with the three stars in Orion's belt, or the constellation of Orion the Hunter and the three stars in Orion's belt. And it said that when they tell the story of the wise men, it said they follow the star in the east, which is actually the star Sirius. And the star Sirius is in the constellation of Canis Major. You have Canis Major and Canis Minor, the big dog and the small dog, Canis Major. And this is where this comes from. And we know Sirius, we know the Dogon, and the Dogon talk about the Sirius A and Sirius B star systems. And they talk about how they're from the star Sirius and things like this in their mythology, right? So all of this history is connected. Okay, all this history is connected. All right, now, the Irish culture centered around a rich oil tradition. So although there were a small number of Christians on the island when Patrick arrived, most Irish practiced a nature-based, quote-unquote, pagan religion. The Irish culture centered around a rich tradition of oral legend and myth. When this is considered, it is no surprise that the story of Patrick's life became exaggerated over the centuries. Spinning exciting tales to remember history has always been a part of the Irish way of life. Now, Patrick was never canonized as a saint, okay? He may be known as a patron saint of Ireland, but Patrick was never actually canonized by the Catholic Church. First of all, when Patrick dies in 461 AD or 462 461 AD, Catholic Church doesn't even exist. They're centuries away. Catholic Church is founded in mid 11th century AD. Now, this is simply due to the era he lived in. Yeah, the Catholic Church didn't exist. During the first millennium, there was no formal canonization process in the Catholic Church because the Catholic Church didn't exist. After becoming a priest and helping to spread Christianity throughout Ireland, Patrick was likely proclaimed a saint by popular acclaim. But just because somebody was made a saint, doesn't mean they were good. See, oftentimes we confuse being a saint with being good, just like the word great becomes synonymous with good. If you look at the word great in the dictionary, I have a Webster Collegiate Dictionary. They have 13 different definitions for the word great. Only two have anything to do with being good. Okay, so once again, we have to look at the definitions of these words and understand etymology. All right, now, if we look at here, so there was, I'm going to go to page 193 and 194 Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization, which really gets deep into dealing with the Druids, which is really important to understand. But I want to go to this first here. There was an article that I was looking at today. Was St. Patrick really saintly or a criminal? Was St. Patrick really saintly or, well, you know what? We'll go to that one after I deal with Nile Valley contribution to civilization. We'll go to that with Patrick. Now, I want to look at, okay, I want to look at this here also. So, just a second, because I had these laid out. I want to go somewhat in order. All right, how's everybody doing? All right. Yeah, that's next. Okay. I want to look at page 195 and 193 and 194 of Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization by Tony Browder. So this gives us a better understanding of Patrick and why I said Patrick was a mass murderer. Let's look at this here. Okay, it's a little blurry, but I have an old copy. My copy of Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization is from 1994. So I have to get a new copy. Where the hell is that book? Yeah, see, my copy is from 1994. All right. And not only do I have this book, I also had a study guide that came along with it as well. All right. From Tony Browder. So my book is old and beat up. I need to get a new copy because it's falling apart. But if we look at this here, this deals with some history of the Druids. And it deals with St. Patrick. All right. So over in the on the right hand side, it has some information dealing with the Dahuti. OK, who we just talked about. And Dahuti was known to Europeans as Hermes Trismegistus, Hermes thrice great, Hermes Trismegistus. OK. And Hermes was a philosopher, priest, and king. He was regarded as the god of wisdom, or deity of wisdom, science, medicine, magic, measurement, mathematics, and he is said to have authored innumerable books on these and other subjects. Masons, or Freemasons, because the foundation of Freemasonry comes out of the teachings in the temples in ancient Kemet, okay, the ancient Kemetic mystery system. That's the foundation of the teachings in Freemasonry, which really comes from the Knights Templar, formed in about 1118 AD during the Second Crusades. And when the Moors go in 711 AD into the Iberian Peninsula, the day known as Spain and Portugal, and they go throughout Europe, and they're going into Italy and Prague, Czechoslovakia, they're going to Czechoslovakia and Austria, Germany, things like this. They go into France, and they're teaching Europeans. Okay, all this stuff comes back to kick us in the behind, by the way. But anyway, there's a group that's formed called the Poor Knights of Christ. The Poor Knights of Christ, and they're formed during the Second Crusade, and they're going to learn from the Moors, okay? And they become very powerful, very wealthy, very educated. And so they're formed right about 1118 AD, okay? And what's going to happen is they're going to be, you have a group of them in France that are going to be rounded up October 13th, 1307, Friday the 13th, October 13th, 1307. They're going to be rounded up eventually, you know, a lot of them are going to be killed and they're going to be disbanded. But what happens is those teachings from the Knights Templar go underground, and later they're going to resurface as the Freemasons, Yorkshire Rites of the Freemasons, and Rosicrucians and things like this, these different what we call secret societies, or what Browder calls societies with secrets. Okay. And then Freemasons are going to come here in Virginia, 1607, and afterwards, and you're going to have like 50 of the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence were Freemasons. Okay. So they're dealing with a watered down version of teachings coming from ancient Kemet, ancient Egypt. And you look at the symbolism, you look at the Washington Monument, which is a Tekken coming from Asar or Set in Heru. It's a symbol of resurrection. Okay, but that's a symbol coming from Freemasonry. So you're going to see symbols in Freemasonry, which come from ancient Kemet, come from the Nile Valley region of Africa. That's our stuff. But if you don't know who you are, okay, you don't know how to claim what's yours. You don't know when you see your stuff. You just attribute it to other people. So you have Dahuti. Let me go back to this here. You have Dahuti, and in you're going to have the Greeks refer to Dahuti as Hermes. Now, Hermes is said to have authored 42 books, which contain the wisdom of ancient Egypt. All right. According to Manly P. Hall, the Romans and later the Christians realized that until these books were eliminated, they could never bring the ancient Egyptians into subjugation, all right? And the Freemasons regard Hermes as the author of all Masonic initiatory rituals. Now, books on the Hermetic sciences were said to contain information regarding the ancient Egyptians, ancient Kemetic peoples' understanding of immortality, which was based on the knowledge that the body is the tomb of the soul. During the Greco-Roman occupation of ancient Kemet, and we know that the Greeks invaded in 332 BC under Alexander the Greek or Alexander the Great. During the Greek and Roman occupation of ancient Kemet, the soldiers formed, these Greek and Roman soldiers formed a secret body for specialized scholarship and training in the Hermetic sciences. They're dealing with a watered down version of teachings coming out of ancient Kemet. They became known as Druids. They became known as Druids and later moved from Egypt or Kemet into Greece and Rome before establishing a school in where? In Ireland. Before establishing a school in Ireland. Now, if we look at this here, the Druids, the word Druid in Old Irish means he who knows. And the Druids practice something called the Gnosis, which means true knowledge, okay? And they wore a helmet with the uraeus on it, which was the cobra, okay, coming from ancient Kemet. All right, now, let me go back to this here. I want to go back to this slide. Okay. So, they became known as the Druids and later moved from Egypt into Greece and Rome before establishing a school in Ireland. Now, if we look at the main portion of 193, now this information is in the section of the book, Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization. This section of the book is called The Development of European Secret Societies. The Development of European Secret Societies. Okay, George G.M. James was killed by a secret society for writing that book. Yeah, so George G.M. James wrote Stolen Legacy. George G.M. James wrote this book here, Stolen Legacy. Okay, Greek philosophy is stolen Egyptian philosophy by George G.M. James. Brilliant, brilliant book. And George G.M. James in this book, he talks about how the African Moors were the custodians of the ancient Egyptian mystery system coming from ancient Kemet. Okay, so if we look at this here, one of the most enduring aspects of Nile Valley civilization was the proliferation of its scientific and philosophical thought, which became known outside of ancient Kemet as the mystery schools or the Hermetic sciences. From the earliest of times, the masses of Europeans, now pay attention to this. This may go outside the circumference of some people's awareness. Just because you disagree with it or don't like it, or it may apply to you, if it applies to you, but it doesn't mean it's not true. It just means you have to do some research to understand what I'm talking about. Okay. So from the earliest of times, the masses of Europeans were poor and ignorant, while only the most fortunate men, noblemen, lords, scribes, and various religious figures or various religious leaders were provided with an education. Of this group, okay, so that may be like the top 10% in European society. Of this group, an even smaller number knew how to adequately read or write. The dogma of Christianity was readily available for the masses of people who were poor and ignorant. While the educated elite studied the ancient teachings, which were also called gnosis or true knowledge. Well, wait a second. Hold on. Okay, stop it. Time out. So if the educated elite were practicing what is called the gnosis or true knowledge, and they are manipulating the poor and ignorant masses and keeping the masses poor and ignorant and making European Christianity, it wasn't Christianity in its original form, because early Christianity looks a lot like traditional African spiritual systems. Okay. So this is Europeanized Christianity. If they're making Europeanized Christianity readily available for the masses, while the educated elite are dealing with a watered down version of teachings coming out of ancient Kemet, then you have to ask the question, well, wait a second, hold on, what's really going on here? Because what the educated elite are dealing with is called the gnosis or true knowledge. Well, if what you're dealing with is called the true knowledge, what are you giving to the masses who are poor and ignorant and uneducated? So let's continue, because it gets deeper. The dogma of Christianity was readily available for the masses of people, while the educated elite studied the ancient teachings, which were also called gnosis or true knowledge. The newly emerging schools of Hermetic, Neoplatonic, and Gnostic thought in Europe were loosely based on the Nile Valley principles of education coming out of the Nile Valley region of Africa, okay, like ancient Kemet. These teachings were designed to awaken within an individual knowledge of self. This knowledge led to an awareness of the powers of God, which exists within man, as expressed in the myths of Osar, Osset, and Heru. So this is what the ruling elite are dealing with. They're dealing with our stuff. This knowledge led to an awareness. This is really important, because the teachings that they were dealing with were designed to awaken within you knowledge of self, which connects you to the supreme being, connects you to God, and awakens within you the power of the creator. So you elevate your conscious level, you elevate your spiritual level to come into your full power. This knowledge led to an awareness of the powers of God, which exists within man, as expressed in the myths of Asar, Osset, and Heru. This philosophy was in direct conflict with Christianity. This philosophy coming out of ancient Africa was in direct conflict with Christianity, which taught that man was conceived in sin and that salvation could only be gained through Jesus the Christ, the Pope, or other accepted intermediaries. One example of the clash between these opposing ideologies can be found by studying the symbolism incorporated in the story of St. Patrick and the Druids of Ireland. Peter Tompkins, in his wonderful book, Secrets of the Great Pyramid, provided a clue to this mystery in a brief overview of the Druids. Peter Tompkins said, Druid in Old Irish means he who knows. Julius Caesar, our earliest source on the subject, considered the Druids highly educated and well-organized. In De Bello Gallico, he commented, it is especially the object of the Druids to inculcate this, that souls do not perish, S-O-U-L-S, souls do not perish, but after death pass into other bodies, and they consider that by this belief, more than anything else, men may be led to cast away the fear of death. Men may be led to cast away the fear of death and to become courageous. They discuss many points concerning the heavenly bodies and their motion, that's called astronomy, the extent of the universe and the world, the nature of things, the influence and ability of the immortal gods, and they instruct the youth in these things, end quote. So Browder goes on to say that the Druids were also known to dress in a style similar to the priestly kings of ancient Kemet, or the Nesubiti pharaohs in ancient Kemet. Their heads were adorned, bottom of the page, their heads were adorned with a uraeus, which was the symbol of the cobra that was worn on the crown of the Nesubiti or pharaoh in ancient Kemet. Because of this symbolic imagery, the Druids were often referred to by outsiders as the snake people. Their presence and ideology were viewed as a direct threat to the development of Christianity in Ireland. Because they're dealing with teachings coming out of ancient Kemet that awaken within you, knowledge of self and the powers of God that are inside of you. So Pope Celestine I in 432 AD said, gotta go, gotta go. In 432 AD, Pope Celestine I sent a former British slave named Patrick into the region to convert the population to Christianity. To convert the Irish to Christianity. In the name of Christianity, Patrick's army killed thousands of Irishmen, and he is said to have founded more than 300 churches and baptized more than 120,000 persons. Now, this could be an exaggeration. But he killed a whole lot of Irish people. He killed a whole lot of Irishmen in the name of Christianity to convert them to Christianity. Patrick also introduced the Roman alphabet and Latin literature into Ireland. He was rewarded by the Vatican with sainthood. And today, millions of people throughout the world celebrate St. Patrick's Day on his feast day, March 17th, in honor of a mass murderer. And since the Roman Empire sends him into Ireland to convert the Irish to Christianity, because they're the Roman Empire is expanding. You can also call Patrick a colonizer. Now, to the average person or average African American who dresses in green, wears shamrocks, and marches in parades, this day commemorates the myth of the man who drove the snakes out of Ireland. What most people fail to realize is that the snakes St. Patrick drove into the sea were not the snakes that crawled on the ground, but the snake people who walked on 2 feet and were once called Druids. So Patrick's claim to fame largely is killing the Druids, which were dealing with a nature-based religion, and the Druids are dealing with a watered-down version of the teachings coming out of ancient Kemet, ancient Egypt. And many of us are so backwards that we sit up here and celebrate a mass murderer. It's eight. I ain't make this up myself. I mean, tell me I'm wrong. Prove it. We'll sit up here and participate in honoring a mass murderer who forced on the Irish, and the Irish are dealing with teachings that are closer to what our ancestors practiced coming out of ancient Africa. And we sit up here and participate in stuff and have no clue what we're doing. So I want to go, for the sake of time here, I want to go to I want to go to 7 surprising facts about St. Patrick's Day. Well, you know what? Let's go to this other one. Was St. Patrick really saintly or a criminal? This is from irishcentral.com. I was looking at this today. Now, also, if you like this type of information, you can support the African History Network. $TheAHNShow through Cash App. $TheAHNShow through Cash App. And also through PayPal, paypal.me/TheAHNShow. We're celebrating our 12th year anniversary of me broadcasting the African History Network show. We first aired March 10th, 2010. Started out on the Harambe Radio Network, and then after a few months went to Blog Talk Radio, and I was on the Empowerment Radio Network in 2014, 2015, 2016 with Dave Anderson and Warren Ballantyne, and then Bev Smith from BET, and Professor Griff was on there also for a while. And then Roland Martin came to the network. That's how I hooked up with, that's how I got connected with Roland Martin. And then I started on 910 AM Superstation WFDF in with my show April of 2016. So I've been doing the African History Network show for 12 years. All right. Okay, so if you'd like to sign up for information, you support the African History Network, $TheAHNShow through Cash App, $TheAHNShow through Cash App. Also through PayPal, paypal.me/TheAHNShow, paypal.me/TheAHNShow. And we have the information at our website, AfricanHistoryNetwork.com, AfricanHistoryNetwork.com, also right on the homepage. All right, so I want to look at this. I want to look at this article here from irishcentral.com. Was St. Patrick really saintly or a criminal? Because just because somebody was made a saint don't mean they were good. Okay. And then the other question we have to ask is good to whom or good for whom? This is from February 24, 2022. Was Patrick saintly, as he is made out to be? Okay. This collection of facts from his relatively hard pinned down biography may mean he was not all as good and holy as we once thought. Okay, so if we look at this here quickly, okay, so it talks about, although accepted as being active during the latter half of the fifth century, Patrick's birth date cannot be dated. Some records claim he came to Ireland 432 AD, died 462 AD. Some sources say 481. Others say he died in 492, but most of them say 461 or 462 AD or Common Era. Okay. Okay. So we skip. Let's see. I want to go here. Is the most, okay, the most famous love Irish history. Okay, so that gives background information on Patrick. Glad that coming from Confessio. So let's see here. It was founded. Okay. The gifts. Interestingly, they portray a quite different from the good saintly character we have been led to believe. They claim he was something of a tempestuous warrior, attacking Druids and their idols and cursing kings and their kingdoms. This ties in with some of the myths about him, which do not describe a peaceful, benevolent man of God, but rather a zealous tyrant. They also intimate that he targeted the conversion of females, preferably those of royal status and wealthy noble women, accepting gifts from them and persuading them to become nuns and found religious order. Okay, let's reduce the size of that. Okay, and found religious order, much to the chagrin of their families. He also targeted the poor. He also targeted slaves and the poor. Who were only too eager to find a way out of the drudgery and heart of their lives. Most famously, Patrick is said to be responsible for driving all serpents from Ireland. This is an interesting story because, according to naturalist Nigel Monahan, keeper of natural history at the National Museum of Ireland in Dublin, quote, "At no time has there ever been any suggestion of snakes in Ireland. So there was nothing for St. Patrick to banish." As I've said before, he should know, having searched extensively through Irish fossil collections and records. There's also a piece when you do a seven, I think it's in Seven Facts about, from the History Channel, Seven Facts about St. Patrick, Seven Surprising Facts about St. Patrick. And they deal with actually fact number two is dealing with, there were no snakes around in Ireland for St. Patrick to banish. Okay. We already know the sacred. We already know how the sacred. Okay, we already know how the sacred number three was, how sacred the number three was to ancient pagans. It is a pattern seen repeated over and over again in all things considered important and powerful to them, such as the maiden mother crone aspect of certain female Irish deities, birth, life, death, mind, body, spirit, and so on. The pagans had long considered the shamrock as a sacred symbol. It's three heart-shaped green leaves representing rebirth and the cycle of life. Comes as no surprise then Patrick should choose to use the three leaf shamrock to illustrate the Christian Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Clearly, it was a symbol that pagans resisted giving up, And the church was very clever at adopting the pagan customs. They could not destroy, and using them to illustrate their own beliefs. Okay, read the rest of this article here. Was St. Patrick really saintly or a criminal? From IrishCentral.com, February 21st, 2022. Okay, and then something else very quickly I want to look at here. I have a lot more information, but we ain't going to get to all of it. So, okay, we did that. Was he a criminal or not? If we look here quickly at seven surprising facts about St. Patrick. And this is from history.com, which is the official website of the History Channel. They asked the question, who was the real St. Patrick? Was that legend about the snakes true? And why did so many St. Patrick's Day traditions start in America? We'll look at a couple of these here. We're not going to look at all of them. Okay, so the real Patrick was born in Ireland. So while St. Patrick's Day is associated with wearing green, green wasn't his color, by the way. I said it before. Green was not Patrick's color. His color was blue. They just got us all screwed up. While St. Patrick's Day is now associated with wearing green, parades, when they're not canceled, and beer, the holiday is grounded in the history that dates back more than 1500 years. The earliest known celebrations were held in the 17th century on March 17th, his feast day, marking the anniversary of the death of St. Patrick in 5th century Common Era. Okay, so we already talked about he was born in Roman Great Britain, born in Ireland. He wasn't Irish. There were no snakes around for St. Patrick to banish from Ireland. Ireland is a cold climate. There's no history of snakes ever being in Ireland. Okay. It's believed that's a metaphor for him having out the Druids, the snake people, the Druids. Now, among legends associated with St. Patrick is that he stood atop an Irish hillside and banished snakes from Ireland, prompting all serpents to slither away in the sea. In fact, research suggests snakes never occupied the Emerald Isle in the first place. There are no signs of snakes in the country's fossil record. Okay, no signs of snakes in the country's fossil record. And water has surrounded Ireland since the last glacial period. Before that, the region was covered in ice and would have been too cold for reptiles. Imagine that. Leprechauns are likely based on Celtic fairies. Now, a lot of people talk about the Twa. Ancestors to the Twa, the short statured Africans who are derisively called pygmies, and they talk about the Twa, because leprechaun means small bodied person or small bodied fellow, and the Twa was short statured, and the Twa were known for doing magic and things like this. So it's believed that the leprechauns were actually came from the Twa. The leprechauns were actually in reference to the Twa. Now, the redhead, The red-haired, green cloth leprechaun is commonly associated with St. Patrick's Day. The original Irish name for these figures in folklore is Lobersin, Lobersin, meaning small-bodied fellow. Belief in leprechauns likely stems from Celtic belief in fairies, tiny men and women who could use their magical powers to serve good or evil. In Celtic folk tales, leprechauns were cranky souls responsible for mending the shoes of other fairies. Okay, the shamrock was a sacred plant. It was a three-leaf clover. Four-leaf clovers are extremely, extremely rare. But it was a three-leaf clover associated with Ireland for centuries. It was called the Cymru by the Celts, by the Celtics, and was considered a sacred plant that symbolized the arrival of spring. According to legend, St. Patrick used the plant as a visual guide when explaining the Holy Trinity. By the 17th century, the shamrock had become a symbol of emerging Irish nationalism. Also, the first St. Patrick's Day parade, the first St. Patrick's Day parade was held in the U.S. When people in Ireland had celebrated St. Patrick, while people in Ireland had celebrated St. Patrick's Day since the 1600s, the tradition of a St. Patrick's Day parade began in America and actually predates the founding of the United States. Records show that a St. Patrick's Day parade was held on March 17, 1601 in a Spanish colony in what is now St. Augustine, Florida. We know that was Spanish territory first before it became part of the Union. And Juan Ponce de Leon, the Spanish conquistador, we know goes into Florida in 1513. He has along with him an African by the name of Juan Garrido. Juan Garrido was born in West Africa about 1480, and it's believed that Juan Garrido was the first African that we know of by name. Now, he wasn't the first African here because we know that African people have been in this land we call the United States of America going back at least 51,700 years. And Dr. David Imhotep, who's a friend of mine, and he deals with this in his book, The First Americans Were Africans, Documented Evidence. And this is even before Native Americans even come into existence. And page 14 of his book deals with the discovery by Dr. Albert Goodyear, who's an archaeologist at the University of South Carolina. And in 2004, Dr. Albert Goodyear made a discovery in Allendale County, South Carolina. And they found 13 different types of evidence that thoroughly documents an African presence in the land we call the United States of America, dating back at least 51,700 years ago. This is before the transatlantic slave trade. This doesn't mean slavery did not happen, just means that African people were here in this land, living and building civilizations tens of thousands of years before we were told that we were brought here chained and shackled and conquered by Europeans. They found artifacts, architecture, campsites, carvings, footprints, and lava. Genetic M174D haploid groups dealing with DNA and genetics, linguistics, painting, skulls, skeleton structures, and tools. They found 13 different types of evidence thoroughly documenting an African presence in this land we call the United States of America. This is before Native Americans come into existence. So what this means is that this was our land stolen from us. And these were the Khoisan. The Khoisan have the oldest DNA on the planet. They're the ancestors to the Ainu and the Twa. The Khoisan, they go all around the world. They were here in this land also, short-statured Africans. This is Dr. Albert Goodyear. This is an article from ScienceDaily.com. They came out in 2004, okay? This article is 18 years old. New evidence puts man in North America 50,000 years ago. New evidence puts man in North America 50,000 years ago. And this is a summary of the article that talks about Dr. Albert Goodyear's discovery. This is a picture of Dr. Albert Goodyear. He's a white archaeologist, European-American white archaeologist. The summary from sciencedaily.com, which is a scientific website, they deal with scientific discoveries, archaeological discoveries, things like this. It says radiocarbon tests of carbonized plant remains where artifacts were unearthed last May along the Savannah River in Allendale County by University of South Carolina archaeologist Dr. Albert Goodyear indicate that the sediments containing these artifacts are at least 50,000 years old, meaning that humans inhabited North America long before the last ice age. And this deals with the Khoisan, who were the short-statured Africans. In October 2012, genetic study published in Science magazine found that the Khoisan in Southern Africa are the oldest ethnic group of modern humans, the Khoisan, with their ancestral line originating about 100,000 years ago. The Khoisan, formerly called the derogatory term Bushmen, are genetically unique, and no other currently known population had separated so early from our common modern human ancestor, according to the report. The Khoisan live mainly in southern Africa, in territory spanning Botswana, Namibia, Angola, Zambia, Zimbabwe, and South Africa. They are largely divided into two groups, hunters and gatherers, known as the Sans people, and keepers of livestock known as the Khoikhoi people. The Khoisan language include the distinctive click sounds that are not found in the languages of their neighbors. Okay. And you can check out the article, Five Ethnic Groups That Prove that the first humans were black, from AtlantaBlackStar.com. All right. But these are all slides that I use in my online classes. So this is some of the type of information that we deal with. But all this history is connected. Okay. All this history is connected. Now, okay, so we dealt with seven surprisingly. We were talking about Juan Ponce de Leon and Juan Garrido, but African people were here in this land for tens of thousands of years before the Spanish come, before the Dutch come in the 1600s, early 1600s, before Jamestown, Virginia, before they're bringing the Europeans, the Anglos and the Saxons, because the term Anglo-Saxon refers to two group of Germanic people. And when they talk about Germanic people, another term for them would be barbarians, the Anglos, the Saxons, the Jutes, the Lombards, the Picts, the Franks, okay, things like this. These groups of Germanic people, the Vandals and the Visigoths, who the Moors are fighting against in 711 AD when Tariq ibn Ziyad leads the Moors into the Iberian Peninsula, okay? So you're going to have these groups of Germanic people who are also called barbarians. And the Anglos and the Saxons come here to this land that we call the United States of America in 1607 and, you know, set up the Virginia colony and other colonies, New England and Maryland, all, you know, that history, and you deal with 13 colonies, okay? So all this history is connected. This is why it's important to go through a timeline of history and look at all this history chronologically. All right, now, we got that. There's one other one quickly here that we'll look at. And this is dealing with the history of the Knights Templar. The history of the Knights Templar. And the Knights Templar are going to study the teachings that the Moors take into Europe. All right, let's see here. We're finishing up that one article. Okay, records show that a St. Patrick's Day parade was held on March 17, 1601 in a Spanish colony in what is now St. Augustine, Florida. The parade and a St. Patrick's Day celebration a year earlier were organized by the Spanish colony's Irish vicar, Ricardo Artur. More than a century later, homesick Irish soldiers serving in the English military marched in Boston in 1737 and in New York City on March 17th. Enthusiasm for the St. Patrick's Day parades in New York City, Boston, and other early American cities only grew from there. In 2020 and 2021, parades throughout the country, including in New York City and Boston, were canceled or postponed for the first time in decades due to the outbreak of the COVID-19 virus. Okay. And that reminds me of the great pandemic, the Spanish flu pandemic of 1918 and into early 1920, when parades were canceled, schools were closed, churches were closed, businesses were shut down. The people wore masks, surgical masks, like people are wearing today. They stopped shaking hands, things like that. All right. So this other piece here, History of the Knights Templar. Very quickly here, History of the Knights Templar. After Christian fighters captured Jerusalem during the First Crusade is 1096 AD. After Christian fighters captured Jerusalem, the First Crusade, groups of pilgrims from across Western Europe began visiting the Holy Land. Many were killed while crossing through Muslim-controlled territory during their journey. Around the 1118 Common Era AD, a French knight named Hugues de Payens founded a military order along with 8 relatives and acquaintances, calling it the Poor Knight of the Temple of Solomon, later known as the Knights Templar. With the support of Baldwin II, King Baldwin II of Jerusalem, they set up headquarters on the sacred Temple Mount and pledged to protect Christian visitors to the city of Jerusalem. After facing initial criticism by religious leaders in 1129 Common Era, the Knights received the formal endorsement of the Catholic Church and support from Bernard Clairvaux, a prominent abbot. Okay, so it goes through, and you can read the rest of this. It goes through and talks about them. This is what this is the tunic that they wore, and they had the red cross on it. A soldier wearing a uniform of the Order of the Knights Templar. And 1303, the Knights had lost their foothold in the Muslim world and established a base of operations in Paris. On October 13, 1307, Friday the 13th, scores of Knights Templar, French Knights Templar, were arrested along with the order's great master, Jacques de Molay, charged with a host of offenses ranging from heresy to devil worship and spitting on the cross to homosexuality, fraud, and financial corruption. The men were brutally tortured. Many, including de Molay, confessed under duress. King Philip then convinced Pope Clement V, who had raised concerns about the Knights Templar's secret initiation rites and practices in the past, to launch his own inquiry. In 1310, dozens of Knights Templar burned at the stake in Paris for recanting their earlier confessions during their trials. Jacques de Molay would suffer the same punishment in 1314 AD under pressure from King Philip. Pope Clement reluctantly dissolved the Knights Templar in 1312 AD. Okay. But the Knights Templar are studying some of the teachings that the Moors took into Europe. And when the Knights Templar disband, the teachings go underground, okay, and they're going to resurface Later, hundreds of years later, they resurface as the Freemasons, as Rosicrucians, things like this, other secret societies. All right. Okay, hold on. Let me make sure that was everything. We got that history. Nice Templar. Okay, if you like this type of information, hopefully you learned a lot. You can support the African History Network, $TheAHNShow through Cash App, $TheAHNShow through Cash App. Also through PayPal, paypal.me/TheAHNShow. This helps us keep doing the research, stay on the air, keep broadcasting, pay some of the bills, etc., because this is a lot of work. At our website, I just posted a link here for Cash App and PayPal. At our website, AfricanHistoryNetwork.com. We have the information there as well. This is our official Cash App account, $TheAHNShow through Cash App. When you go to it, it says Michael and shows my picture there. These other ones here are fake African History Network Cash App accounts. Okay, these other ones are not me. And we have the link here on our website also for Cash App, and we have the PayPal button, donate button. So we're on Monday through Friday, 11 p.m. to midnight Eastern Standard Times. Eastern Standard Time, the African History Network show, Monday through Friday, 11 p.m. to midnight. And on Sundays, 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the African History Network show. Download the iHeartRadio app. Search for 9:10 a.m. Superstation WFDF. You can listen to all the shows live and my show as well. And then also search for the African History Network show on iHeartRadio, because we have our own page there. They have about 300 of my audio podcasts. You can click here to listen to podcasts. It takes you to our Blog Talk Radio page, blogtalkradio.com/TheAHNShow. You can advertise with the African History Network, advertise your Black-owned business, your African-American-owned business. Current promotion, buy 1 month, get 2 months free. Email us at AHNShow@AfricanHistoryNetwork.com. And be sure to register for the online classes I teach. The classes are a lot of work. Takes a lot of preparation, but you're going to learn a lot. It's a lot of preparation on my part, a lot of work on my part, but you learn a lot. This also helps support the African History Network as well. On Saturdays, I teach ancient Kemet, the Moors, and the Maafa, understanding the transatlantic slave trade, what they didn't teach you in school. So if you like the information I share with you today, those slides that I showed you, those are from some of the slides from the online class. I'm the one that puts all the slides together. So this class is on sale, $60, regularly $130. Ancient Kemet, the Moors, and the Maafa, understanding the transatlantic slave trade, what they didn't teach you in school. We deal with thousands of years of history and what leads up to the transatlantic slave trade taking place. We can't start studying our history and slavery. We have to deal with the sequence of historical events that lead up to the transatlantic slave trade taking place. And we also deal with the 800-year occupation of Europe by the Africans known as the Moors, and deal with what the Moors take into Europe. And they're taking the teachings from ancient Kemet, from ancient Egypt, into Europe. And these teachings are going to bring Europe out of the Dark Ages, okay? So as soon as you register for the class, you can start watching the content. The class is on sale, $60, regularly $130. The second class I teach on Sundays, the second class is Sunday, 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., From Civil War to the Civil Rights Movement of Black Power, 1865 to 1968. And this class basically picks up where the first class leaves off. Okay, this class basically picks up where the first class leaves off. And we start in 1803 with the Louisiana Purchase. And we're going to go from there and go through to deal with the Mexican-American War and Civil War, and we go throughout history and deal with what happened to us after slavery ended. What were the laws and policies put in place so we can understand what happened to us, so we understand where do we go from here, okay? That's from the Civil War to the Civil Rights Movement and Black Power, 1865 to 1968. We have a bundle pack where you can register for both classes. You can register for both classes for only $100. Bundle pack is on sell right now, $100, $260 value. Even after, so we do the sessions live. All the sessions are recorded. So as soon as you register, you can start watching content. We have content on demand. You can join us in class for the next classes. And even a year from now, you still have access to the full class. You can go back and watch all of them. If you've taken any of my online classes with me in the past, and I've been teaching these classes on and off since 2017, email me at AHNShow@AfricanHistoryNetwork.com, and you'll get 50% off on the bundle pack, okay? If you've taken any of my online classes with me in the past, email me at AHNShow@AfricanHistoryNetwork.com, and you'll get a 50% discount. I'll roll you in it, and you can start watching the content. You can also email us at TheAHNShow@gmail.com also, all right? All right, look, we have to get out of here. Remember, the African History Network, we focus on educating, empowering, and inspiring people of African descent throughout the diaspora and around the world, because right now, let's correct your own behavior. It's not over till we win. Hopefully, you learned a lot today. I'm not telling you don't celebrate St. Patrick's Day, but hopefully, after you research this information, it will, if you choose to continue to celebrate, it'll at least change how you celebrate St. Patrick's Day. And we should study the history of all these European holidays we've been taught to celebrate, so at least you know what it is that you are participating in, okay? And read African People, the European Holidays and Mental Genocide as well by Dr. Shaka Musa Barashango. And check out also at our website, all my DVD lectures and digital downloads are there as well at our website also. But check out, we have a recommended reading list of books at the top of the page. We have a recommended reading list of books, but as you get deeper into this information, you'll see that, book list right here. As you get deeper into this information, you see that your thoughts create feelings, your feelings create actions and behaviors, your actions and behaviors create results. And what you do for yourself, what you do to yourself, and what you allow the people to do to you and get away with is based upon what you think about yourself. What you think about yourself is based upon what you have been taught about yourself. What you've been taught about yourself is based upon everything you've read, heard, and seen about yourself. So you'll see how this information changes the way you think, feel, act, and behave, ultimately changes your results as well. All right, look, we have to get out of here. Remember, at the African History Network, you focus on educating, empowering, and inspiring people of African descent throughout the diaspora and around the world, because right now it's correct your own behavior. It's not over till we win. Wakanda forever. We'll talk to you next time.